Take that down. भगवते वासुदेवाय
Chapter 10, Opulences of the Absolute, text number
20.
Aham Atma Buddhakesha.
Sarva
Bhuta Asaya Svita. Aham Adischa Madhyam Cha.
Bhutanam
Antaye Vacha.
Aham
所以至尊人格神首才同意描述自己的种种赋予。
这意味着他可以征服睡眠。帕帕解释到，如果我们想要去了解奎舍那的话，这一点很重要。 If someone is in the darkness of ignorance, they will not be able to understand Lord Krishna.
如果一个人处在愚昧的黑暗之中，他是无法了解奎舍那的。
So sleep is like darkness of ignorance.
睡眠就是像愚昧的黑暗之中。
Srila Prabhupada was very careful to minimize his sleeping.
所以帕布帕他就非常谨慎的尽量减少睡眠时间。
He would sleep only a couple of hours every night.
他每天晚上只睡几个小时。
He liked to wake up in the middle of the night and do his translation.
他半夜会醒来，然后做他的翻译工作。
And we know also the Goswamis of Vrindavan, they conquered over eating and sleeping.
我们也知道温大文的六个 Goswami, 他们征服了睡眠和进食。
They were so absorbed in Krishna consciousness, they did not think about eating and sleeping.
他们是如此的沉浸在 Krishna 知觉当中，忘记了吃饭和睡觉。
So this, of course, is a very advanced stage of Krishna consciousness.
当然了，这是 Krishna 知觉当中比较高级的境界。
One has to be free from the demands of the body.
一个人他已经不受躯体的需求的控制。
Our tongue likes to always taste many different varieties.
我们的舌头总是想要品尝各种不同品味的食物。
We like to satisfy the tongue with nice food.
我们想要用美味的食物满足舌头的需要。
And after we fill the belly, then we like to sleep.
当我们的肚子填饱了，就想睡觉。
But the liberated souls, they're very careful to minimize their eating and their sleeping.
那些已经自我觉悟的人，他们非常小心谨慎地控制自己，或者尽量减少自己的睡眠和饮食。
Srila Prabhupada used to always instruct his sannyasi disciples that they had to develop the mood like the Goswamis.
帕布帕经常会教导他的托钵僧门徒需要发展像六位 Goswami 的心态。
Because Swamis, they did not worry about their food, and they did not worry about their ship where they would sleep at the night.
六位 Goswami 他们不会担心自己可能要吃什么或者在哪个地方睡觉。
They would live by begging some food here and there.
有的时候他们会到处乞讨。
They would live by the system of madhukari. Madhukari means to take a little nectar from different places.
他们的这个系统叫 madhukari, 然后这个系统就是会在别人家寄宿，不同的人家寄宿。
Just like the bee comes and takes some nectar from the flower.
就像一个蜜蜂会在花朵中采蜜一样。
So Goswamis would live in Vrindavan.And they would simply beg some food from some of the different farmers and people who live there in Vrindavan.
住在 Vrindavan 的六位 Goswami, 他们就会从当地的一些农民的地方乞讨，或者其他的人家乞讨。
They would not worry about eating very palatable dishes.
他们从不担心自己是否有美味的食物可以享用。
And when it came to sleeping,They could sleep under a different tree every night.
睡眠的话呢，他们可以每天晚上在不同的树下睡觉。
They were not attached to being in one place.
他们并不依附于每天待在一个地方。
And they would move through the different forests of Vrindavan.
他们会在 Vrindavan 不同的森林当中穿梭。
And they would accept for shelter some tree.
他们会睡在这个树下。
So this way they conquered over the bodily demands.
以这种方式，他们战胜了躯体的需求。
Bodily demands are four: eating, sleeping, mating, and defending.
身体的需求有四个四项，一个是进食，一个是睡觉，另外一个是交配，再一个是防守。
So.Srila Prabhupada said, when he was a young man, he gave up mating and defending.
帕布帕说，当他还是一个年轻的男子的时候，他就放弃了交配和防御这两项。
And he said, finally, in his old age, he had also stopped eating and sleeping.
当他年纪大了的时候，他也克服了睡眠和吃饭这两项。
So.This kind of consciousness is achieved when one is fully absorbed in consciousness of Krishna.
当我们完全的沉浸在 Krishna 知觉当中，就可以拥有这种知觉状态。
So Srila Prabhupada was often conscious of devotees sleeping.
他们怕经常会注意到复健者的睡眠。
Especially sometimes when Prabhupada would give class, he would notice sometimes that the gopis were not paying attention, that they were sleeping.
尤其是当帕帕的讲课的时候，他会注意到，他会注意到复健者没有专心聆听，可能在打瞌睡。
Sometimes the gopis would argue with Prabhupada. They say, "No, no, Prabhupada, I'm not sleeping."
有的时候复健者会说，哦，帕帕，我没有在睡觉。
But Prabhupada would say, "If your eyes are closed." And you're not moving, then you must be asleep. So Prabhupada did not. Nobody can defeat Prabhupada in
argument.
Anyway, Arjuna is known by this name, Buddha Kesha, that he has conquered over sleep.
所以阿珍娜被给予这个称号布达天煞一个征服了睡眠的人。
There are different names of Arjuna throughout the Bhagavad Gita.
贯穿国家梵歌呢，阿珍娜被给予了很多不同的名字。
He's also Dhananjaya, conqueror of wealth.
比如 Dhananjaya 征服财富的人。
He is also Savyasachi, one who is very expert in firing arrows.
Savyasachi 一个非常善于射箭的人。
So it's known by different qualities.
所以阿珍娜这些称谓是带有不同的品质的。
And this particular quality is relevant at this particular time because Lord Krishna is going to explain his opulence.
不同的品质在不同的地方可能会被提及，在这个地方，主 Krishna。将要谈到他不同的不同的荣耀，不同的富裕。
So because Arjuna is free from that tendency towards sleep and ignorance, the Lord is willing to reveal his opulence to Arjuna.
因为阿珍娜他是超越了这种愚昧和睡眠，所以维什纳他愿意向阿珍娜展示自己的富裕。
We'll read more the third part.
我们会继续读要旨。
Krishna first informs Arjuna that he is the soul of the entire cosmic manifestation by dint of his primary expansion. Before the material creation, the Supreme Lord, by his plenary expansion, accepts the Purusha incarnations, and from him everything begins. Therefore, he is Atma.The soul of the Mahatattva, the universal elements. The total material energy is not the cause of the creation. Actually, the Mahavishnu enters into the Mahatattva, the total material energy. He is the soul. When Mahavishnu enters into the manifested universes, he again manifests himself.As the super soul in each and every entity. We have experienced that the personal body of the living entity exists due to the presence of the spiritual spark. Without the existence of the spiritual spark, the body cannot develop. Similarly, the material manifestation cannot develop unless the supreme soul, Krishna, enters. As stated,In the Subhava Upanishad, Prakriti Agni Sarva Bhutanam Tar Yami Sarvasheshita Narayanaya. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is existing as the Super Soul in all manifested universes.
Krishna 首先告诉阿朱那他是以其基本扩展而存在于整个宇宙展示的灵魂，在物质创造之前，至尊主以其全权扩展接受了至尊享乐者身份的诸多化身，并从他产生了万物，因此他是灵魂，是整个物质能量的灵魂，是宇宙元素。整个物质能量并不是创造的原因，实际上马哈维什努进入了整个物质能量。当马哈维什努进到已展示的宇宙之中，他再次以超灵的身份，在每一个生物中 展示自己。我们有经验知道生物躯体的存在是因为有灵性火花的缘故，没有灵性火花的存在，躯体就不会成长。同样，没有至尊灵魂奎师那的进入，物质展示也不会发展。苏巴拉乌帕尼沙德上说，至尊人格神手以超灵存在于所有已展示的宇宙之内。
So Lord Krishna is beginning his description of opulences by which Arjuna can remember them.
So Krishna 开始讲述他的富裕，以此让阿朱那能够记住他。
And the very first opulence Lord Krishna mentions is that he is the super soul in the heart of all living beings.
Krishna 讲述的第一个富裕是他是每一个生物体当中的超灵。
So Srila Prabhupada then explains how.The material manifestation comes about only due to the presence of the super soul.
Prabhupada 就讲述了宇宙的展示，宇宙的展示是因为有了超灵的存在而存在的。
Just like the material body has no life without the soul.
就像如果没有灵魂存在的话，我们的物质躯体就不会有生命。
In the same way, the cosmic manifestation, the whole material creation, has no life without.Presence of the Mahavishnu.
同样的，如果没有马哈维什努，整个宇宙的展示它也不会存在。
Mahavishnu is the original Purusha, sometimes called Karana Dakshayi Vishnu.
马哈维什努它是最初的 Purusha, 有的时候它被称为 Karana Dakshayi Vishnu.
So Mahavishnu or Karana Dakshayi Vishnu is laying on the causal ocean, and from him the universes are coming.
所以马哈维什努又是卡拉诺达卡沙伊维什努，他是在孕育之阳中。
So without the presence of Mahavishnu, the Mahatattva has no life, has no development.
如果没有马哈维什努的话，马哈托塔塔他是没有生命的，就不会发展。
But when Mahavishnu comes into the cosmic into the elements.Then the development of the creation begins.
当马哈维什努进入到这个元素当中，物质的展示便开始了。
So Srila Prabhupada points out that the cause of creation is not just simply the material elements.
所以帕帕的解释到，宇宙的展示、创造的展示，并不仅仅因为是物质。
Materialistic scientists they will simply say that life comes from chemicals.
那些物质主义者的科学家，他们会认为生命是由物质开始的。
And they try to explain that the origin of life is simply due to interaction of the elements.
他们尝试解释生命最初的发展是源于不同元素之间的不同元素之间的碰撞。
They don't accept that there is such a thing as the supreme law.
他们并不接受至尊者的存在。
They don't believe in creation.They believe simply in evolution.
他们并不相信创造，他们只相信进化。
And they think that the whole creation, the whole cosmic manifestation comes about just simply by evolution of chemicals.
他们相信整个宇宙的展示仅仅是因为一些化学的变化而产生的。
And Prabhupada spent a lot of time encouraging his scientific disciples to preach to the scientists.Convince them that life does not come from chemicals, but life comes from life.
帕帕就鼓励他的一些科学家门徒尝试在这个科学的领域向其他科学家传教，去说服他们，去告诉他们，生命并不是从物质开始，而是由灵魂开始。
And Prabhupada also had his disciple, His Holiness Bhaktiswarup Damodar Maharaj.Begin what is called the Bhaktivedanta Institute to preach to the scientists.
Prabhupada 有一个门徒叫Bhaktiswarupa Das Damodar, 然后他是建立了这个 Bhaktivedanta 学院的人。
And their work, Prabhupada considered their preaching to be very important.
Prabhupada 认为他们的传教非常的重要。
Those people who are able, who have a scientific background.They should try to introduce the principles of Krishna consciousness to other scientists.
那些具有科学背景的人，或者在科学领域当中的人，应该尝试向其他的科学家或者同样领域的人讲 讲述回师那的知觉的原则。
Of course, it's a difficult preaching field.
当然了，在这个领域当中传教很困难。
One time, there was a scientist in Sri Lanka, and he was proposing that he could create life.
有一次在斯里兰卡，有一个科学家声称自己可以创造出生命。
So one of Prabhupada's disciples challenged him to it, and he said, I will bet you $10,000 if you cannot create any life.
一个浩瀚的门徒就向他提出挑战，说：“我赌$10,000，我觉得你创造不出生命来。”
And it got a lot of publicity. A lot of publicity at the time. People were appreciating.
当时这个就制造了很多新闻，大家都很关注这件事情。
I'm sure the Prabhupada was very pleased, and he encouraged the devotee to do this kind of preaching.
帕帕德很高兴，他就鼓励门徒去做这样子的传教。
Because the scientists are always proposing that in the future, very soon, just now coming, we're going to create life.
因为科学家们总是声称，不久的将来我们就可以创造出生命来。
But Prabhupada said it is all like a post-dated check. That you have no money just now in the bank, but you tell the man, I will give you my check for $1,000,000.
这个就像是总是到不了的这个支票，就像你对一个人承诺，日后我会给你一张100万美金的支票，但是我现在没有钱。
So Prabhupada said the chicken is a better scientist. The chicken can create eggs every day.
所以帕帕的说，这个母鸡是更好的科学家，因为母鸡每天下蛋制造出生命来。
The scientists all they do is talk that in the future, very soon, just now coming.
科学家们却声称啊，不久的将来我们就能创造生命，但是现在也创造不了。
It is all lying and cheating.
这些都是谎言和欺骗。
And just like going to the moon, they say they went to the moon.
就像登陆月球一样，他们声称已经登陆了月球。
But nobody ever went again.
但是从来没有人再去过。
It is all cheating.
这些都是欺骗。
So those people.Who want to be cheated, they'll find a cheater.
那些想要被骗的人总会找到一个骗子。
And certainly in the field of science, there's a lot of cheating goes on.
在科学的领域有很多欺骗的事情在进行。
They're always claiming that in the future we will solve this problem, we will cure this disease, we will live forever.
他们总是声称在不久的将来我们就会解决这个问题，然后或者治疗某种疾病，或者长生不老。
But in the course of time, everyone dies and leaves the body.
但是每个人的生命都是有期限的。
So Lord Krishna is explaining that he is the super soul in the heart of all living entities.
所以主回师那在解释，他是每个生物体心中的超灵。
Because the soul is present in the body, there's light in the body. There's consciousness. Consciousness is a symptom of the soul.
因为身体当中有灵魂的存在，所以躯体才有生命，才具有知觉。因为知觉是灵魂的知觉是灵魂的象征。
And as soon as the soul leaves the body, then there's no more light in the body.
当灵魂离开一个躯体，这个躯体立马就失去了生命。
Then Prabhupada explains how the same way there's a soul in the universe.
所以像是这样子，帕帕想解释的是，在每一个宇宙当中也有这样子一个灵魂的存在。
And because of the presence of the supreme soul, then the whole universe can develop.
因为在每个宇宙当中有一个类似的超灵的存在，这个宇宙才得以发展。
We have different universes coming out from the body, from the course of Mahavishnu.
从马哈维什努他的毛孔和他的体内有不同的宇宙展示出来。
And then Mahavishnu expands into each universe as Garbhodakshayi Vishnu.
然后马哈达克什维什努他进入到不同的宇宙，在那里他是 Garbhodakshayi Vishnu.
And then from Garbhodakshayi Vishnu you get Shivadakshayi Vishnu, who is the super soul in the hearts of all living entities.
从 Garbha Daksha Vishnu 又扩展出来 Shiro Daksha Vishnu 是每个生物体当中的超灵。
And that super soul is not only in the hearts of all living entities, it's in every atom.
这个超灵并不仅仅是在每个生物体之内，它在每个原子之内都有。
Srila Prabhupada would often say, just think how busy Lord Vishnu must be. He's in everyone's heart and he's giving them knowledge, remembrance, and forgetfulness. So he reciprocates with every living entity according to their desires.
所以他根据每个生物体自己的欲望, 他会和他们进行互动。
We'll just read the rest of the purport.
我们读剩下的要旨。
The three Purusha avatars are described in Srimad Bhagavatam. They are also described in the Satvata Tantra. Vishnus tu Trinirupani Purusha Ham Atavidhu. The Supreme Personality of Godhead manifests three features as Karamadakashayi Vishnu, Garbhudakashayi Vishnu, and Shiradakashayi Vishnu in this material manifestation. The Mahavishnu or Karamadakashayi Vishnu is described in the Brahma Samhita, Yakarana Navajale Bhajate Sma Yoga Nidram. The Supreme Lord Krishna, the cause of all causes, lies down in the cosmic ocean as Mahavishnu. Therefore, the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the beginning of this universe, the maintainer of the universal manifestation, and the end of all energy.
在Dattva上也有描述至尊人格神手在物质展示中展示为三个形体Karanodakshayi Vishnu原因之阳Vishnu Gargodakshayi Vishnu运旦之阳Vishnu Keshoridakshayi Vishnu牛奶之阳Vishnu Brahma Samhita这样描述了Mahavishnu至尊主Krishna万缘之源 以马哈威士努之躯躺在宇宙之阳上，所以至尊人格神手是这个宇宙之始，是宇宙展示的维系者和一切能量的终结。
So sometimes people will say, "Oh, this is all very fantastic that you talk about these Vishnus and how universes are coming out from the body. We never see anything like this. We don't have any proof of this."
有人会觉得这一切听起来很精彩，我们讲这些Vishnu呀，然后他们宇宙的创造，但是我们从来没有见过证明，什么能证明他们？But
we say, well, our theory of creation is much more realistic than the scientific theory.
但是我们会说到关于创造，我们的这个理论比科学家的理论其实要更加的有理有据。
The scientists, they claim the whole material creation comes about just by chance.
科学家说整个物质的创造发生只是偶然的。
And they have theories like the Big Bang theory, that there was a Big Bang, and from the Big Bang, all the order came about.
他们的理论是像大爆炸理论，通过大爆炸所有的一切存在开始发生了。
Just like we could say, in the night there's a Big Bang, and you wake up in the morning, and there it is, Melaka.
我们可能会说，在晚上有这样一个大爆炸，早上起来的时候，我们看到了马六甲。
The whole city came about by a big bang.
整个城市因为大爆炸，通过爆炸就存在了。
Right, this is a scientific theory.
这是科学家他们的理论。
No, did we ever see a big bang like that that created everything?
但是我们有见过这样子的爆炸导致一切的产生吗？
There's intelligent beings behind the creation.
我们认为在创造的背后是有具有智慧的生物存在。
There's intelligent beings who arrange everything, just like in a city. There's intelligent people managing the affairs of the city.
在一切的背后一定是有智慧的存在，就像在一个城市当中，是有人在背后操纵和控制着这个城市的发展。
They have to make sure there's enough food. There has to be enough grains, there has to be fruit and vegetables, there has to be oil, there has to be electricity. Everything has to be provided for the needs of the people.
就像这些管理城市的人，他们要保证城市人有足够的食物、足够的水、有电，然后有油，他们需要提供这一切。
Can we say it all just came about by chance?
我们不能说这一切都是偶然发生的。
All the roads and all the network and power supply, everything, it all just came about by a big bang.
我们想一想，这可能吗？所有的一切，这些电呀、水呀。都是通过爆炸发生的。
Our people say it all came about from the black hole. Everything appeared through the black hole.
也有人说一切都是从黑洞而来。
So the atheists, they have many crazy theories of how this world came about.
所以那些无神论者有很多很没有头脑、疯狂的理论来阐释这个世界的存在。
But we accept the Vedic knowledge of how life came about.
但是我们接受的是伟达的理论，生命是如何而来。
And we find perfect explanations, are they?
在伟达的理论当中，我们找到完美的解释。
And the different information, how the different elements come about in a very systematic, scientific manner.
其中他会解释不同的元素是怎么而来的，这是非常有科学依据的解释。
Different elements, earth, water, fire, air, ether, how the creation comes about from subtle to gross.
所以他会解释像是不同的元素，水火土以太，这些元素是怎么由精微到更粗糙的创造。
First of all, there's earth, ether, and then from ether then comes the air, and then after the air then comes the fire, and then the water, and then the earth.
他会讲是从以太产生了空气，从空气产生了火，从火产生了土，从土产生了水。
And with each of the first of all, fire, then water, and then air.
从以太产生了空气，然后产生了火，产生了水，产生了土。
From subtle to gross, the subtlest element is ether, the grossest element is earth.
最精微的，这是一个从精微到粗糙的发展。最精微的元素是以太，最粗糙的是土。
And with each of these sense, each of these elements, a different sense organ is created to facilitate use of these elements.
然后因为这些精微的元素，我们获得了一些感官，这些感官是让我们能够去体验到这些不同的元素。
Just like in ether, there's the element of sound.
就像以太，它是创造了听觉。
And then after ether, you have air. With air, there's the element of sound and touch.
然后以太之后，我们是空气，空气它对应的这个感官是听觉和触觉。
And then there's fire. With fire, there's sound and touch and form.
然后接下来是火元素，它对应的感官体验是听觉，然后触觉，还有形象。
And then after fire, then comes water. And with water, you have taste as well as sound and touch and form.
然后接下来是水元素，它对应的这些感官体验有听觉、触觉、形体，还有味觉。
And finally, you have earth, and with earth, there's the aroma of the earth, the fragrance of the earth.
最后呢，我们是土元素，然后对应了我们的这个嗅觉，比如说对土地的芬芳的嗅觉。
As well as sound and touch and form and taste.
以及我们之前提到的，像是触觉呀，味觉，形体，声音。
We find from the Vedas.Very scientific, progressive information of how the whole material manifestation comes about.
在伟达的经典当中，我们会找到这种解释，这个物质的展示它是如何一步一步发展而来的。
And we learn also how the Lord is arranging for all of these things.
我们也了解到主他是如何一步一步安排着所有的发展。
Through his different expansions.
通过他不同的拓展。
All right. Any questions?
有问题吗？
这个奉献者的信仰和非奉献者的信仰有什么区别？
What's the difference between devotees sleeping and non-devotees sleeping?
Well, a devotee will sleep just to maintain the body for the service of Krishna.
奉献者的睡眠仅仅是维系他的躯体，能够让他在服务当中去取悦回善。
But the non-devotee there for sleep, it's their sense gratification.
非奉献者他们的睡眠是为了感官享乐。
They're simply sleeping to satisfy their own desires.
他们的睡眠只是为了满足自己的欲望。
But the devotee is conscious to regulate his sleeping so that he can use his body nicely with that sufficient.
但是一个奉献者他会有意识的去调节节制自己的睡眠，让自己能够更好的服务 Krishna。这个就是区别。
One's working for Krishna, sleeping also he has to sleep. Just like in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna said, you cannot be a yogi if you eat too much or eat too little, sleep too much or do not sleep enough.
在《菩萨蕃伽章》中 ，Krishna 说，一个瑜伽士他不能吃得太多，或者吃得太少；睡得太多，或者睡得太少。
So is it dangerous to eat too much or to eat too little?
所以吃得太多或者太少都有危险。
Sleep too much or sleep too little.
同样，如果你睡得太多或者太少，也都有危险。
So, you have to be conscious to regulate these things.
所以我们需要有意识的去控制这些事情。
So that we can use the body efficiently in Krishna's service.
所以我们可以在 Krishna 的服务当中更有效率的去利用你的身体。 It's like when we eat the food, we cannot put too much salt, but we cannot eat it without any salt. So how do we control the extent to which we gratify? How do we control the extent to which we engage in sense gratification?
Yes. Well, we have to understand what is necessary for us.
我们要理解什么对于我们来说是必要的。
Just like some people, they have to have more salt.
就像有的人吃饭的时候可能需要放多一点的盐。
And some people, they want one salt.
有的人他可能不想要盐。
And so, the taste, and the thing with people have taste for sense gratification. People have taste for material sense gratification.
所以人们他是有这个感官享乐的欲望或者品味。
Some people are very attached to gratifying their senses.
有的人非常依附于满足自己的感官。
They have to have a lot of opulent food, or they have to have more sleep, or sex also.
他们可能需要有美味可口的食物，需要睡很多的觉，然后需要有性生活。
So sometimes people cannot give up these activities.
有的时候这些人没有办法放弃他们。
But somebody else who's cultivated Krishna consciousness, then they develop a taste for spiritual activities.
但是如果一个人他培养回向之觉，他将会发展出对灵性活动的品味。
Just like we do not say you don't eat, but we say you should eat Krishna prasadam.
比如说我们不会说你不许吃饭，我们说你要吃菩萨的。
And we don't say don't sleep, but we say don't sleep too much.
也不会说不许睡觉，而是说不要睡太多。
And we're not against people having sex. They can get married and have Krishna conscious families.
我们也不反对人们从事性生活，但是要求是结婚，然后去培养有回向大师学的小孩。
So everything can be done in a Krishna.
所以一切可以在具有回向之觉的具有回向意识的情况下去进行。
But if people have uncontrolled senses,
问题是人们有不受控制的感官。
The unrestricted feet and their eating and sleeping and mating and defending.
他们的进食、睡眠、交配和防御不受到任何控制。
Then that creates the, that's going to mean that they're not going to make any progress in self-realization.
这样的话，在自我觉悟的道路上，他们就没法进步。
They're fully attached to the material body and satisfying the senses.
他们完全的依附于物质躯体，想要去满足感官的欲望。
So they enter into the or into the lower species of life.
所以他们会去到更低等的生物星球上。
Because their uncontrolled senses drag them into the lower species.
这些不受控制的感官就会把他们拖到更低等的星球上。
So people to be trained, they have to develop that, they have to develop that pace for controlling the mind and senses.
所以人们需要通过训练去培养对感官的控制。
When an intelligent person hears how he's the servant of the senses, then he'll think about how he can control his senses.
当一个人听到他是这些感官的仆人，就会想，当一个有智慧的人听到自己是感官的仆人，他就会想要了解如何控制感官。
One will develop the desire to master over the mind and senses.
这个人就会发展出想要控制心意和感官的欲望。
So Prabhupada explains that this is practice. It takes practice.
帕帕说这需要通过练习，不断的练习。
Just like the child has to practice walking.
就像一个孩子需要去练习走路一样。
So the same way a devotee has to practice developing a taste for controlling the mind and senses.
同样的，奉献者需要发展出这个品味，去控制自己感官和心意的品味。
Doesn't want to be the servant of the senses.
并不是成为感官的仆人。
He has to, first of all, understand the situation and the need.Do what's required.
首先要了解这个情况，然后去做，需要做的事情。
So before coming to Krishna consciousness, we may have had so many bad habits.
在进入回声来之前，我们可能有很多不好的习惯。
But you come to Krishna consciousness, and then these bad habits can be gradually eliminated.
但是当我们进入回声来之学，这些坏习惯逐渐的可以被铲除。
You lose the taste for material sense gratification.
我们逐渐的会失去对物质上感官享乐的品味。
And we develop a taste for the higher pleasure.
我们发展出对更高的快乐的品味。
There's the pleasures of the stool, the animals which eat stool, the pleasures of the dog and the pig.
例如说一些动物，像是猪狗，它们的享乐可能是吃大便。
But there's higher pleasures who has controlled his mind and senses.
但是对于那些可以控制感官和心意的人来说，他们的快乐是更高级的。
So it's not that there's no pleasure, but there's a higher taste in pleasure.
并不是说并没有快乐的存在，但是快乐也有不同级别，有不同的品味。
We don't want to be attracted to be like a pig and a dog.
我们并不想成为像猪狗一样的他们这种动物。
We want to experience the higher taste.
我们想要去品尝、体验更高级的品味。
So Lord Krishna describes this in the Bhagavad Gita.
主克什那在《菩萨梵歌》中讲到。
Vishaya vinivartante niraharasya dehina raso vajam raso pyasya param drisvarna vartate.The embodied soul may be restricted from sense enjoyment, but the taste for sense objects remains.
所以不是要讲到那些被困在身体当中的灵魂，他们可能进行感官享乐的体验是受到限制的。尽管如此，他们仍然具有感官享乐的这种欲望。
But if he can give up such pleasure, ceasing such pleasure.He can experience the higher taste and be fixed in consciousness.
如果一个人可以放弃这种低级的享乐，去寻求更高级的快乐的话，他的意识可以变得更加的坚硬和稳固。
So the higher taste is there. The taste to understand our spiritual self.
所以更高级的品味是存在的，这种品味是了解我们灵性的身份。
By chanting Hare Krishna and engaging in devotional service.
通过念诵 Hare Krishna 以及参与奉爱服务。
The people can be purified from the lower taste. They can develop the higher taste.
人们可以得到净化，然后从低等的服务解脱出来，去体验更高级的，从低等的享乐来到更高级的享乐，更高级的快乐。
Just like Lord Rishabhdev instructed his sons that they should all do austerity to control the mind and senses.
就像主为沙摩耶教导他的儿子要控制自己的感官。
He told them.Don't be attracted to the pleasure of the pigs and the dogs, which eat stool.
他说不要被那些动物的享乐所吸引，就像那些猪狗会吃大便一样。
Experience first undergo some austerity to control the mind and senses.
首先，我们需要通过一些苦行来学会控制我们的心意和我们的感官。
And when you become purified, then you can experience the higher.
当我们足够净化的时候，我们才能够去体验到更高级的快乐。
So it's not that there's no pleasure.
并不
是。In spiritual life, there's the greatest pleasure.
并不是说没有快乐的存在，在灵性的体验当中，我们可以获得最高级的快乐。
And that is why the devotee can give up the material pleasures because he's experiencing something much greater.
这就是为什么奉献者可以放弃那些低级的享乐，因为他们获得的体验是，比这个要高级很多的。
Super soul is expanding everywhere.
是的，有一个超灵，这个超灵通过它的扩展，扩展到每一个地方。
Just like there's one sun in the sky, but the reflection of the sun can be seen everywhere.
就像天空当中有一个太阳，但是通过各种折射，这个阳光可以传播到各个地方。
So the same way, the Lord in the form of the super soul is one, but he's where in everything, everywhere.
同样主作为超灵，它是一个超灵，但是它可以拓展到各个地方。
By this expansion, he can appear.
通过它的拓展，它可以出现在任何的地方。
It will be explained at the end of the 10th chapter.
在第十章最后结尾的地方会被解释。
After Krishna explains all of his opulences, he says to Arjuna, "There's no need of all of this detailed knowledge."
在比丘那向阿朱那讲述他所有的富裕的时候，他对阿朱那说：“其实了解所有这些详细的知识，并没有需要。”
He said, "With a single fragment of myself, I pervade and support the entire creation."
仅仅通过我的一小小部分，我就可以支持和维系整个宇宙。
So that single fragment, that is the super soul, one super soul which is expanded everywhere.
所以奎师那讲的这小小一部分指的是超灵，它的超灵可以拓展到任何的地方。
How many super souls are here in the room? One. There's one super soul. That one super soul is in everyone.
所以在我们这个教室当中有多少超灵呢？有一个，但是这个超灵它可以拓展在所有的地方。
If I say there's a new interaction, there's something happening.
something good or bad happen to us if it's a regional super soul.
Lord Krishna explained in the Bhagavad Gita that he's not responsible for people's pious and sinful activities. Everyone is suffering and enjoying according to the results of their own activities. The super soul is simply the witness to all of these
things.
He's a upadrasta, anumanta, he's the overseer, and he's the permitter. As a permitter, he's like a well-wishing father, and the father's telling the son, don't do this. This is not good. This won't be good for you. It's not. But often we don't listen to the super soul.
作为一个允许者，他像是我们的祝福者，像是一个父亲的时候，有时他会提醒我们不要这么做，这么做会有不好的结果，但是我们不会去听。
We don't hear the Lord telling us. But the super soul is there as an overseer, and he, just like a father, father tries his best, but sometimes he just cannot convince the son, and the son will go and do what he wants to do, regardless of what the father was telling.
所以主，作为超灵，他在观察着我们的行为。有的时候，像是父亲叫这个孩子不要这么做，但是这个儿子不听话，他非要做自己想干的事。
So the super soul is like, we are responsible for our own
actions.
We sow the seeds of our own happiness and distress.
Maharaj, I have a question. Is there a time? So for the people, like the impersonalists, do they have to surrender to Krishna, to God, in order to achieve self-realization? Sometimes we hear in the Yoga Sutra, like they also say Ishvara Pranidhana, like you would pay obeisance to God or something like that. But do they have to also surrender to Krishna? They can just achieve perfection of self-realization through their own capacity without surrendering to God or establishing like a relationship, realizing a relationship with God. 我的问题是那些非人格主义者，他们如果想实现自我觉悟化，他们最终需要臣服于神呢，还是不需要去觉悟和神的关系，仅仅通过自己的努力就可以实现解脱？
Well, the impersonalists, they're not going to surrender to God.
那些非人格主义者，他们不会向神臣服。
They think that they can become God themselves.
他们认为自己可以成为神。
So the impersonalists, they have some degree of self-realization, that they've detached themselves from material sense gratification. They've understood they're not the body. But at the same time, they haven't distinguished between the soul and the super soul.
They have distinguished.
They have not. They've not been able to distinguish.
但是他们没有办法区别灵魂和超灵的区别。They
simply think there's only one soul.
他们认为只有一个灵魂。So
they think, we ourselves are the super soul.
他们认为我们自己就是超灵。So
their surrender is not complete.
所以他们的臣服并不是完整的。Their
self-realization only takes them to the level of knowing they're not the body, but their Brahman, their spirit.
他们的自我觉悟仅仅能够抵达到意识到自己不是这个躯体，是梵高。But
they don't understand they're the servant of the Supreme Brahman.
他们并没有意识到自己是这个至尊主的仆人。
The there's not only Brahman, but there's the Parabrahman, the Supreme Brahman.
不仅仅有梵光，还有在上面还有 Parabrahman。但是非人格主义者不知道这些事情。Maharaj, do you mean like for them they think the soul and the super soul is the same? They don't have the realization the soul is like the servant of the super soul?
No, they simply have only one soul. They don't have soul or super soul. They just simply have soul.
他们并不知道就是灵魂和超灵的区别，仅仅以为只有一个灵魂。他们意识不是，他们没有意识到还有一个更超然的至尊的灵魂的存在。他们仅仅是以为我是灵魂。他们只是以为最后这个灵魂会融入到梵光当中。
So their goal is liberation, mukti, but their liberation is different.One with the Brahman.
他们的目的就是解脱，但是这个解脱意味着和他包容为一体。
They can give up their individuality.
他们认为自己可以放弃自己的人格性。